So as you know, the panel is the art of community management and the mobile world. We've decided to make this panel completely interactive because we want to get to know you guys and what's important for you. Why are you here? What are you expecting to know about community management? So I'm gonna let each one of our awesome speakers today introduce themselves, starting with Michelle, and then we're gonna start an open conversation.
Hi, my name is Michelle Dow, and I have a startup called Social Swag, which stands for Serving What Advocates Good. And the premise behind it is basically saying that you can do really awesome things for great companies and also promote social good. And swag is kind of involved because it has to be really strong creative, no matter what the campaign is, in my personal opinion. And so that's what I do, cause marketing.
Well, thank you, Michelle, for being with us today. Daniela.
Hi. My name is Daniela Veras. I am DanielaVeras.com. I pretty much work with different companies to build digital strategies. And I work with companies like the Prism Music Group, the Jupiter Circle. And what I do is I help maximize what you're already doing using the internet and social media. So aside from that, I also have a food blog called Hedonist Sheetanist. And I eat a lot. And that's a lot of fun. And I also am an influencer, so they hire me to run different campaigns and be a part of campaigns, promote different causes, brands, projects, that sort of thing.
My name is Grant Stern, and you can find me at Grant Stern on Twitter. That's just like my professional profile. It's my personal thing. So I do a lot of personal food blogging and blogging about Miami, microblogging through there. And I run multiple communities. I run a radio program called The Only in Miami Show, a blog for Huffington. I'm the executive director of a great website called photographyisnotacrime.com, which actually uses community-sourced information and sometimes articles and videos and whatnot. And we actually crowdsource, I'd say, 80% of the articles on this national news journal. And I do a few other things too, but happy to be here with you guys today.
Thank you, Grant. And I am Roxana Frantini. I am the general manager of Ads Miami. We are a full-service advertising agency based here in Miami, and we do pretty much everything from market research to production. And we do focus a lot in social media. Currently we manage, I would say, around 30 social media profiles for different clients, and there's a lot to be said about community management today. So let me ask you a few questions so we can start a conversation. Why are you here today? What are you looking to gain from this panel? Who's the brave one?
Come on, let's see some hands.
Yeah, not everyone at the same time, please.
Well, before you get started, let's just do a quick picture, a quick video for Snapchat. Everybody wave. No! Social media week, yo! Woo! Thank you.
So go ahead.
I had to do it.
So I recently graduated in 2014, and this is my very first job ever. So I'm a communications coordinator for ALMA, which is a Hispanic ad firm here in Miami. And so one of my jobs is our social. And so you don't really learn about social in school. And so I guess just kind of bringing forward that education and really learning what could optimize everything for us.
Awesome.
My name is Edward. I'm a social media manager for ad agency in Boca. I find it difficult to actually create a community that's engaged and actually interact with us and not so much we're just pushing ads towards them.
Okay. Thank you. Anyone else?
I'd like to know sort of the evolution of community manager. Like a couple of years back, we saw a lot of agencies, and now I feel like clients every day are moving sort of towards in-house community management. And on the other hand, sort of how to prevent community management like brand. I supervise some community managers for an agency, and it's sort of something you see every day. 24/7, they're always on, and they get tired and turnover.
Have you set guidelines of growth or metrics for every client like, when you start providing the service? I'm curious to know how you set expectations for your client or about the other.
Curious of the boundaries of intellectual properties. I know that's a big thing, especially with content easily shareable on the internet. So that's what I know about.
OK.
tonight, what's trending here and why?
It's relevant for the community here.
Okay.
I'm from the Climate Avoidance Center. I'm interested in social media, and my challenge is to reach kind of people in terms of politics and decision makers in the cities. And like, they're trying to use social media to grow our brand presence, but they are not all there.
Okay.
I'm interested in how news media can handle managing a community where the same type of conversation and how not much like engage. So the balance of not pushing but engaging as communities. And you have a brand to represent.
Sounds familiar, Michelle. Yeah. Not pushing but engaging.
I would like to know the news that does
create. Alrighty.
Sounds like a good variety of topics.
I'm interested in responding to conversations from customers for companies like airlines and financial companies.
So how to reputation management. Reputation management. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So we have a wide variety of topics. Yes. Go ahead. Last one.
So I'm an outreach coordinator for a nonprofit. So my role in managing marketing.
Awesome. I think we have a lot to talk about today. It's, you know, we were having a conversation upstairs about truly the arts. I mean, it's the topic today is, the name is perfect, because to manage a community, it is an art. It is. There's a fine balance between what you know and what you sense from the community. So, you know, I want to give you, each one of you, the chance to answer, to kind of like answer all these questions. But I think the main thing here will be how to like gather do's and don'ts in that art of, in that fine balance of knowledge and understanding, like connecting with the community. So.
Well, you know, I'd like to talk about your adverse, let's call it adverse management. In other words, when somebody's trolling you, when somebody's angry at you, because that's the most difficult situation. That she called it reputation management, but it's also a discussion with somebody who just disagrees with you. And people in general have a tough time having a discussion with someone who disagrees with them, right? Has anybody here had an argument? Just raise your hands. Have you had an argument with somebody over politics or some issue that you disagree about lately? Yeah? On social media?
Well, you guys are a very agreeable crowd.
Well, what did you do? Did you unfriend them? Yes? No? Did you block them? Did you say a bunch of mean things to them? No? Sometimes people try that, right?
Yeah, we go through that.
But in running photographyisnotacrime.com, one of my tasks, among many tasks, is running social media for a news organization that's reporting on some very, sometimes graphic, violent topics, topics that are at the forefront of the zeitgeist, police brutality, citizen journalism, the interaction between people and their government. This is very, very touchy subjects, all of them. And when you have a troll, you have to confront them head on, but not be mean, sarcastic. Anything that you say, it's going to be interpreted very literally. Very literally. So if you want to have a conversation with this person who you think hates you, if you keep everything to the facts, you don't get angry, you don't get personal, you never get personal. That is the one method that you can use to escalate the situation. And something that we report on is how de-escalating a situation can happen. And one example I can give you is that we had a user on photographyisnotacrime.com who was on our Facebook page, and he was on our page commenting on the page. And every single time we would publish anything, he would comment about what happened in Ferguson, Missouri. We are talking in February, okay? And we're a First Amendment rights website. We do not want to block anybody. Okay, but it got to the point where we had to say, look, this guy is out of his mind. He is just commenting the same comment on every single thing. We're like, hey, we started a new Reddit channel. Come and check it out. Comment. Why are you guys lying about Darren Wilson? So we blocked him, right? Well, he starts emailing us. Like he starts, you know, oh, you guys are afraid of me. You see what happens? You say, oh, go away. Oh, you're trying to silence me. We're like, he'll go away eventually. We didn't respond because we didn't want to raise the profile of this guy who all he has to say is one topic and it happened 8 months ago and he's still not over it.
To segue off that from more like a brand perspective versus like a specific brand, I deal with reputation management all the time in what I do, and I feel like the first step is almost the biggest step, which is number one, just acknowledging that they're saying something that you're hearing. Like sure. That's one thing that you'll find with Starbucks or airlines, or whatever, they're like, you know what, thank you for bringing this to our attention.
Oh, yeah.
We are so glad that, you know, you gave us this feedback. So one of it is being, I mean, that will get rid of probably 80% of the people who are upset because they just want to be acknowledged. I mean, I had an issue with Starbucks when I got food poisoning and I made a tweet about it and I was upset and I immediately had Starbucks respond and say, no, email us, we want to give you a free meal. Right? And that's just a little thing. But secondary, I think, for reputation management is if you can't find a solution, at least acknowledge that you're aware of the problem and try to say that you'll pass it. So like some of the things you can't control as a marketing or community manager. You can't control the fact that a power company has people going to people's door to knock on it so they want to be the customer, to ask to have customers come. But you can say, you know what, like I will reach out to the appropriate channels for you and make sure that your dispute is heard.
That's an amazing point. And actually, I kind of skipped over that step because people in our community were telling this troll, this person who kept posting this, the people in our community were saying, hey, get over it, man, you know? Like, we didn't have to even do that first step. The people in our community were kind of like policing the community. So then he starts contacting us through our web contact, like every few days, and we're like, ah, leave him alone. And finally, I was like, okay, this guy is clearly obsessed. I looked him up. He's in Ulysses, Kansas. Do you know how many people live in Ulysses, Kansas? Not as many people as in this room, okay? He was a former police officer, a city council candidate in Ulysses, Kansas, and what we did was we reached out to the guy by phone using an anonymous dialer, not using a personal cell phone number, anything that could trace him back to our personal location because these people can be obsessive and you don't want somebody showing up at your doorstep. And I had a conversation with him. And he told me, oh, I'm upset about this. I said, listen, I understand that you're upset about this. But it's so off topic when we're trying to just tell people about our Reddit channel and you're talking about this issue that happened 8 months ago. So I'll tell you what, we're gonna give you another chance. The guy's name is Dan Witter, by the way, if you ever run into him. So I'm like, okay, Dan, we know who you are. You don't know who I am, but I'm gonna give you another chance. Now the guy occasionally sends in a story for us to report on. And he's still commenting, and he still says a bunch of dumb stuff, but at least he doesn't spam every single post.
We manage the crisis, which is, you know, the objective is to manage the crisis. I mean, we have a lot of, I would say, guidelines, you know, to manage crisis, because you have to be prepared. And each brand needs to, I mean, from the agency perspective, each brand has to develop a tone to manage the crisis. Even though the process would be pretty much the same, acknowledging the person and directing the person, you know, to an email and handle the situation privately.
I want to piggyback on that as well. My background is also in PR, so the way that I look at social media may be different than like from I mean, having my own personal properties, but I can have a little more liberty at that point and say whatever I want personally. But from a brand standpoint, you do want to have a plan in place. You want to go and discuss with your PR department, what are the certain responses you can use? What are the certain ways to segue a conversation and diffuse it? The same way what she was talking about with acknowledging the problem, saying, okay, maybe we don't have a solution right now, but this is what I can offer you. Because like she said, at the end of the day, people just want to be heard. So if you are a brand, the very first thing that I would do is like look at some of the common things that people would maybe complain about, certain situations that you may run into, and have a plan for that. You know, some of the things that I would work on with each brand is saying, okay, like one of the brands I work with is Samsung. There was like a battery issue, something that was happening in Brazil, and batteries were blowing up. you know, we had a huge meeting about it, and we sat and we talked about what are the certain responses that you can give people in the media or on social media or wherever it comes from. You have to be able to be prepared to have a direct response for it. Now, from a personal standpoint, maybe you want to go and make phone calls. I don't. I don't want to necessarily go that far to harass somebody, but I do like to be diplomatic.
We waited until the fourth email before we called them.
All right, man. No judgment here. But that's what I would do from a brand standpoint. From a personal standpoint, you know, that's a little bit different. And that, I mean, if someone has questions about that specifically, then we can address that separately.
Yeah. Well, the other thing I want to say is that at the end of the day, customers, consumers, whatever, will judge you more on your response than the person's reaction.
Yeah,
so
I totally
that's
agree.
The key. And, you know, stay professional, stay kind, stay attentive.
And that's where the opportunity is, to
right.
really make a big difference and for the brand to shine, is how you respond to their reaction.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's about civility. And to share some great advice or a great tidbit of advice from a very wise man from who I take counsel, he is my attorney, so I gotta, you know, share his paid advice with you guys for free. He said a great rule of thumb is just to have three rules. So let's just say three rules would be have a plan before you're actually typing whatever it is you're saying. Have a plan or think about it when you're making that post. Always be civil and listen, because like Michelle said, if you're listening, you're de-escalating the situation.
Yeah.
You're hearing their concerns, and just by doing that, you're maybe getting to the point where you can hit step three, which is let them know that you're allowed to agree to disagree. Being able to agree to disagree, but doing it civilly, is very important.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And you know, I'm going to take two steps back and visit what building a community is, because there's definitely something around. I mean, where our topic starts is building that community, creating a community, and then sustaining that growth throughout the time. That's what's important. And that's when topics like engagement or crisis management or reputation management, all those topics are relevant. So someone here, you mentioned something about managing social media within the advertising agency. And you know, that's where I think we kind of like should start talking about how to create truly a community and matching the expectations of the client for those who are in the agency field, with truly what the community can give. So why don't we talk a little about community building?
Okay.
Sure.
Well, community building for me starts on the back end. I'm big into research. I'm big into looking at data. I'm big into finding out everything about my market. And what, let's say it's, which I do a lot of blogging with food, and I did PR for restaurants, like let's say hospitality. I would look at everything that's happening there, look at trends, look at where the pain points are and the emotional points, and then look at and build my strategy around that, build a content strategy, have that go in line with everything else that the brand has going on so that there's some synergy there. So some people would maybe give you like some blanket advice about, well, okay, this is what you do. And I think the research goes into that and to inform what your process and your strategy is going to be, even within the same industry. Like one example that I love to give people is I worked with a restaurant group, and they had five different restaurants. And within the five different restaurants, each one required a different type of content. So how many of you have heard of Salumeria in Midtown?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Salumeria, okay. What about Segafredo on Lincoln Road?
Mm-hmm.
Segafredo, you've heard of Segafredo. Okay, so those are owned by the same restaurant group. Two different strategies in the type of content that go on there. And so at Salumeria, people are more about the real gourmet food. And so when I talked about the content, it had to be delicious and yummy, and that food made you want to lick the screen. That's how it had to be, right? Because that's what the people wanted. But that, again, that required me looking and seeing what people were resonating with. On the other side, Segafredo, they didn't care about food. They cared about cocktails, pictures of people having fun, drinking, having a good time. If I posted something about yummy food, it'd be like, okay, cool. But if there were a bunch of girls drinking cocktails, it's like.
Where are we going?
Exactly. So it's more about looking at the industry as a whole, and then looking at the brand and what's really resonating with it. Is it fun? Is it exciting? And building your content around that. Because each community and each brand is going to be a little bit different, and it's going to require some work from you on the back end to figure out what's going to resonate.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with you. Michelle.
And what are the metrics? So you speak about content. So somebody or this restaurant, when they approach you, what expectations do you set for the client? What are you measuring? So once you determine that strategy, which is, you know, I'm going to go for X type of content, how do you measure, you know, X amount of time later, whether that content was effective or not? Or
okay.
How much more would you run?
I'm really glad you asked that, because it really depends. For me, I build a strategy based on the goals that the company has. So let's say, for instance, it's a brand new company, and what they want to do is create awareness. My strategy would be different then, you know, on what I would do and how I would use it and what type of content I would create. If it were the case where they wanted to bring more people in the door, then that would require different types of content and a different type of strategy that goes in line with everything else that they have going on, whether it's specials or promotions and things like that. You know, so depending on what the goal is, that then I would determine my KPIs.
So I think earlier you asked this similar, and I think it's really good, managing client expectation.
Yeah.
So number one, absolutely, you have to listen. There's two kinds of listening, right? There's listening, and then there's waiting to speak. So with a client, you really have to do the first kind of listening. You have to sit down. I mean, I generally, when I first get a client, spend an hour in what I call a strategy meeting. And during that time, I am listening to what they're saying, what they're not saying, the years of agency experience that I have for my nonverbal, like what I'm reading of their body. I look at their office, I see what's on their table, you know what I mean? Like, I am literally just a sponge during that hour. And then I go back and I look, at this point I have logins, so I look at all the insights I can see. And I see, okay, people are biting on this, this, and this, and they're not on this, this, and this. So that's a starting point. But you guys know, social media is fluid. You have to change your strategy sometimes twice in one day. Like, you have to figure out, there's like that line you have, that guideline, based on the client's goal, always. But during that time, it's gonna go like this. So the way I report to clients, you always want to report positive. Like, you don't want to be like, oh, you went down 400% this week. I don't know why, let me find out, right? So I think that no matter what you do, you can frame something in a positive light. So especially when you have multiple platforms you're working on, let's say you're using Google Analytics, or you're using Sprout, or Hootsuite, or any other content management platform. All of them provide insights, as do Facebook and Twitter and Pinterest, and all these other sites have insights that you can read. So sometimes when I'm managing four or five platforms for a client, maybe Facebook dropped like 300% in one area. Maybe like the likes went down, but the engagement went up, you know? So I'm gonna focus on that part of the response that I can keep them really engaged. Because this is how social media works, right? It's like it's a constant up down, and you want the slope to be up in the end. So I think that experience gets you there, like years of doing it wrong and learning the hard way gets you there, but it's also how you frame it and the way that you communicate it to the client.
Just to piggyback on something she said really quick too, half the time your clients don't know what they want. So it's really—
Isn't that why they're
probably more than half the time.
But that's the thing, and that's why what she was talking about, that active listening and really listening to them and asking the right questions so that you can create those goals. Because half the time they're just like, I just want you to manage my social media, like just post stuff, right? You know? And you can't just post stuff. It's not like, oh, here's a picture of like, you know, my salami. That's not a really bad
thing. Snapchat. Hashtag salami.
Hashtag eggplant. But it's like a lot of times they don't know what they want. So that, it's up to you to figure that out and set those expectations yourself, and really analyze the data, look at like what's resonating, what's not, and then tell them like, look, this is where I see opportunities, you know? But that has to come from you first. Because a lot of times they don't understand what really managing a community is. And that they don't have to be on every single freaking network, you know?
Yeah.
You know what, I'm going to start with your point and then go way off in the sunset. Because I do something very different than what these two ladies do, which is that I only manage communities that I've built and that I'm managing for my own purposes. I'm not a hired
guy.
You're
not hired to.
Yeah. So it's a little bit different. Like, I run a community called Heat Fan Club, which we had a blog with the Sun Sentinel when they were doing a community blog initiative. I manage the Photography Is Not a Crime communities. I have my Only in Miami radio program and our websites and a podcast and all that stuff. They're very different communities. And I'm also involved in this movement that's called No Walmart in Midtown. And that's what I wanted to, you know, you said you don't have to be on every platform. Well, trust me, I'm on every platform for a lot of things. But I've been fighting Walmart in this neighborhood, six blocks away from here, for 3.5 years. And even though I'm on every platform with everything else, we don't even have a Twitter account. We just have a hashtag. We just went with the hashtag and said, you know what? Hashtag's good enough for this. Mm-hmm. I mean, here we are 3.5 years later. We have a change.org petition and a domain pointed at it. If you're doing community management, don't be afraid to buy a web domain and just use forwarding. And just forward it at something. Well, I don't have a website, but I'm gonna buy, you know, sundaysoccer.com and forward it at twitter.com/soccersunday. And then you have a domain now. So you don't have to be on everything. You just have to be on the right platforms. And like they were saying, you have to figure out what your goals are and then use a platform that will help you move towards those goals.
Yeah, I've discovered that generally it takes me around 3 months with each client to really feel like I'm ingrained in their vision and voice. That's kind of the time frame where I'm like, okay, now I've actually listened. I've thrown some bait out to the community. I see the right community is responding to this. And you know, like, it takes time, which is one thing that the brand owners never know. They expect you to show up and within a couple days have it all figured out and make them more money. So like she said, like, there was one meeting I had with, I think it was like something big, maybe it was an American Express meeting back when I was in the agency world. And I was listening, we were all there, we were all like huge, like when you go with like the whole agency, there's 10 people doing a presentation, we're so important. And I'm like watching these people who are sitting there from, I think it was American Express, and they're saying what they want. But then I watched one of the girls who's taking notes write on her notepad. We had, one of the things we did was sports, like somehow, and it had nothing to do with what they wanted, but she wrote it in huge letters and circled it. So when it was my turn, I got up and I threw everything out except for what that girl circled. And I spent the whole time on it. And that's what we ended up getting the client for. So it's really paying attention to the nonverbals as well. And the same thing, if you already have a boss, like, the same thing goes to them. Like, you need to kind of listen to the pauses. Even if you've been working with them for 5 years, there's something that they're not saying that you're gonna figure out just from that relationship, even if it's 2 hours in.
Can I ask a question? Who here is here because they want, because of a job situation? Like, they have a community management job? Raise your hand. Who's an independent person that's working on social, like, independent and doing community manager for hire?
Any personal anybody? Brands? People who are building their personal brands?
Not personal, but corporate brands.
And people that are building brands themselves, like for their own purposes, like what I do. Okay, cool. So it's a mix. Good.
Yeah, it's a mix. And I would say, I would add, you know, listen to the category. Because the category will tell you how the community already moves, how it behaves around restaurant or whatever it is. It could be advocacy, whatever. Yeah. Just truly pay attention to truly listen. I mean, when we say, you know, when we get hired, we also spend quite a long time doing the listening. And the clients are like, but I gave you the account a month ago. And we're like, yeah, and we're doing the listening. And we're building a strategy that would connect your expectations as a business with the expectations of a community that would end up being your customer or your client.
We have a question. Yes. Let's take this
one. I look for social media in Instagram and you have very good pictures. And when you said that the client maybe is like, just post or whatever, how do you get them to buy that really good picture and buy you the service of creating their
content? Quality of the content.
You're saying how to get really good picture, how to get the client to buy into getting really good pictures of.
Yes. The client that's saying just post.
They don't. I guess I'm trying to understand your question.
The client that you spend money.
Like, to spend money on getting creative? Professional pictures on creative. Okay. It definitely definitely depends on, for me, if it's a highly visual brand like food is, yeah. I mean, you have to spend money on that. You have to get professional pictures, especially for your website. I would give them a competitive analysis of other people in the same industry mm-hmm. they're competing with, and showing them, I'm like, this is what they're doing, and this is what you look like. Okay. I actually did this same exercise with when I was working with Spanish Broadcasting System. I managed 20 of their different radio accounts all over. That's exactly what I did. I said, do you see this? This is what you should be looking like. This is what you look like. And when they see that, and they see what their competition is doing, you know, it's going to awaken that competitiveness in them, you know? And that's one strategy on how I would get them to buy into something more high-end like that.
Okay, go ahead. You mentioned that you work with Samsung.
Yes.
I have a question. I manage Latin America for the brand for Latin America, in Latin America. And I'm trying to figure out whether I should hire, do you have a community manager by country? Is that how Samsung does? Or is it managed out of Miami, or is it just one community manager, or do you have a community manager?
I hope it's not just one.
Well, she was here.
From a PR standpoint, I have I worked with different agencies in each country to inform the language and the vernacular, because each country in Latin America especially has their own ways of expressing themselves. I actually managed LATAM for Samsung also.
That was my question.
Yeah, I did. So, for instance, the way they speak in Argentina is different than the way they speak in Cuba. I also did the Caribbean. So the way that they use their English and the different slang, you have to kind of, depending on the brand, and if it's a fun brand, you kind of want to incorporate a little bit of that, that slang. So personally, I would get some of the general content done in-house, pass it through the brand, and then have it get a little tweaked by my local agencies. So it still has the same messaging, but with the local flavor.
Yeah, and it you maintain the strategy.
Mm-hmm. Right. So and maintain the voice and the message. Because especially when you're working with these larger corporate brands, that voice and the message is super important. They're so particular about that. So that would be the way that I do it.
And that brings up a very good point, and it's about team building. The team that you have behind each brand, and how important it is to build a strategy when you're managing a community. Because when you have several people managing, one single brand throughout the region, it could be just a team within an agency. You do need a strategy.
And let me speak about that briefly. you have to be able to manage a group of people to complete a task. So what do you use to manage that? I want hands. What do you use to complete a group task? Anybody? Group task?
Trello.
Basecamp, Trello. Any others?
Slack. I love Slack. Yeah.
Anybody here using Facebook groups?
Yeah.
Anybody?
Yeah.
I tried
Facebook groups.
Kind of gets lost with everything else.
Well, there's a Facebook groups app, which is super useful, as these two ladies can attest. The thing is, it's about the size of the group. A group of 5,000 people, a lot of people are probably turning off the notifications. But some of the things that we've accomplished with groups under 100 people, with very, very well-written group statements, would absolutely astonish you. Whether it's putting on a conference or figuring out what the news is on a national basis or whatever the heck it is. That's how we do a lot of our work with photographyisnotacrime.com.
That's how we did this.
Yeah, of course. And what we do is we have a main group with about 90 to 100 people, never more than 100, that are feeding in what we're, what's going on, right? And then we have a few subgroups that are regional, so if something's happening that's maybe not nationally important, they can talk about it in there. And that's how we manage the managers, through Facebook groups.
I will say, the Social Media Club of Southern Florida uses Facebook group for our communication. But there's only 15 people in it, so it's very manageable. I think for too many people, that could be really... Mm-hmm.
Well, that particular group you mentioned has a 5,000 person public group.
The larger group, but the board has its own small, mm-hmm.
Sure,
It does still get a little drowned out, though, I will say.
Yeah.
But they have to tag us for it not to. So, I mean, there's a balance. Personally, we tried, what's the one that starts with an A? I don't even remember.
Asana.
We did Basecamp, and we were going to do Slack, and somebody's like, why don't we just do Facebook? And that ended up being the easiest, because it's like not one other platform we have to deal with.
Right.
But that's,
I mean, there are other platforms that are useful for that kind of thing, but for communication, for just general purpose, everybody's seeing the task and being able to give input.
And it's a very interesting thing, because then you're building a community that you're also managing, but it's your inner community.
I love to take whatever it is that I have and to give it to other people. Whether it's like, for me, it's more about what cause can I promote? What emotions can I evoke? What do I want to make people feel? What conversations do I want to start? Mm-hmm. And then I look at it, again, I start with my goal in mind. Everything that I do, whatever strategy it is, starts with the end in mind, and then I work backwards and build a strategy around that.
It's cool, because like actually what I do is very much the opposite of what she does. I just do whatever I feel like doing. But there are a few things I do more than others.
Apparently. I care more about you.
She cares about you. No, I care about you too. You know, I post a lot of food porn. Anybody that follows me knows that I'm a big foodie. But they don't all know that I spent like 7 or 8 years working in restaurants. I was a busboy, I was a cook, I was a waiter, I was a delivery guy. So, you know, I was a manager, and then I actually got into marketing and digital branding through the restaurant business all the way back in the ancient time before the really good internet in 2000. Actually, what had happened is I worked for a dot-com company. And tell me if you guys have heard of this company before. It focused on the college market. It had its own built-in messaging system, profiles, dating, groups, photographs. Anybody recognize this? No? Anybody? College? Yeah, college? No?
High Five?
Collegeclub.com?
No.
No? Yeah, I see. It was 15 years ago. But we signed up. I personally signed up about 40,000 people that were going to Miami-Dade and University of Miami to our website. And then went from that to working in a restaurant. and then designed all of their digital everything, and then moved into a career in actually graphic design and web design and hosting, and then moved out of that. And the point is to be flexible, but to show these different aspects of whatever it is you're doing in your social. Like I had a mortgage brokerage business, that's how I pay my actual bills, along with this wonderful media venture, Photography is Not a Crime, which we think will be incredibly profitable by this time next year. But it is a nonprofit, so incredibly profitable means we'll be paying a lot of other people, mostly. But you know, just be yourself. Let people see parts of yourself that you think might be interesting to them, or you just want to share, and do it in a visual way. And just realize that everybody's going to judge you based on that, but it doesn't matter, because they're not you. You don't have to listen. Whatever it is that you're doing, just enjoy it. Like when you're doing food porn all the time, like there's like that small part of the community, and you know what I'm talking about? They're like, how could you eat that? I'm like, man, you didn't watch me eat. You just saw a picture of what came out from the chef.
Community or fiance?
Both. Only
I just want to piggyback a little bit for those of you that are building a personal brand and that are looking, you know, to figure out, okay, so what type of things do I post? When I said mostly that I'm thinking about my community, it's not so much that I'm molding myself or my platform around my community. It's more that it has to resonate with me, but it also has to resonate with my community. Mm-hmm. I know that the people that follow me, the people that add me, are because they're resonating with me and who I am and what I represent. So the first thing, if you're looking to build your personal brand, is to decide what your values are and what do you want to be known for? Who do you want to be? And then also inject pieces of your personality. So let's say, for instance, a popular one with women is fashion blogger, right? You want to be a fashion blogger. There's so many fashion bloggers, but they're not you, okay? So how are they not you? Maybe you're a fashion blogger with a penchant for Star Wars. That's kind of interesting in a way, because it's like a nerdy, like there's a girl called the hippie nerd that she loves like Star Wars stuff, and she's a fashion blogger. So
she's real.
Yeah.
Sure.
Or she exists in real life. Imagine that. But so think about what sets you apart. Think about what's different about you, and then take that to the nth degree. You know, and just really be more you, more of you. and people resonate with that. When the more you are, the more you express yourself, it's like, what was that quote I read about passion? It's like passion is like lighting yourself on fire. People will come for miles to watch you burn. You know?
Steve Jobs, don't do it the same as your competition, do it different.
Well, let me follow up on what she said too. There's a very important word she said, which is blogging. And I would say that if you're looking to build up a personal brand or a brand that's just like you as an individual, writing is very much central. Writing or photography or a combination of the two is very much central to that. So, you know, you've got your own, the Hedonist Genius blog, right?
That one's grown way bigger than me and everything.
Yeah. Like, I started actually with a real estate oriented blog, and it's for a very special consulting project, a niche is an important word. Just write that one down, find a niche. It was this very niche-y thing in real estate that I was doing, and I started writing it anonymously at first and got a lot of attention for it and wound up on CNBC for what we were doing. And it's like, if you have that writing, eventually somebody will read it.
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't matter if somebody is reading it today. As long as it's published, one day it could be read. And, you know, like, I have a Tumblr blog, and I've had one for many, many years, and it's my grantstern.com blog. And it is white space with whatever the picture of the day or whatever I'm doing. You could just hop on there and be like, what does he think is the most important thing that he's doing on social media? Because that's all I post on there. If it's a podcast, if it's a picture, if it's Instagram, if it's just what I'm thinking right now, that it's a way to go. And that way people know where to find what you're talking about.
Can I say one thing before we're done?
Yeah.
I know it's like time,
yeah.
But I just wanted to say, and this goes for no matter what you do, I don't care if you're in social media or not, if you're not being good to you, if you're not having fun, you're doing it wrong. Okay, number one. Number two, and some of your employers might disagree with me, and some of these guys might disagree with me, but I personally believe that in order to be effective, you have to take time unplugged. Like, you have to give yourself time for your life outside of your job. And I get some of your employers are going to be like, I don't care, 2 hours response rate, whether we're, you know, on a Sunday or a Tuesday or whatever, 2 a.m., 4 a.m. But there has to be boundaries. And at the end of the day, the consumer and the client will get that. And also, even though it's not your brand, who you are shines through. Like, she does Tastemade, or did. And I saw her personality through a brand she was working with, and I cared more about that brand because she put her personality in it. So to engage people, the same way you engage, it's like BuzzFeed said this really awesome thing a couple years ago at Social Media Week New York. They were asked a similar question, and he used this great analogy, and it was, being a community manager is like hosting a party. And just like any party, you don't want to be that guy who shows up early and is like, hey, my name is, and I do this, and I do this. Like, no, we don't like that guy, right? You have to understand social dynamics the same way as a party. You want to be that guy maybe who's too drunk and does whatever, that's fine, but does your brand want you to be that person? Mm-hmm. So it's listening, but it's also balancing the fact that you have to have a life and you have to enjoy it while you do it. And that translates.
I absolutely agree with you. We're getting to the end of the panel, but can we take just 5 minutes for a short Q&A? Okay, awesome.
Okay, so I think a lot of people maybe can relate to trying to do the community work too, having zero followers, and having great content, but that content going to the void. So you can have this great idea, this great, how do you build that first fan base where, like,
okay, so a few years ago, I was at Publix, right? Anybody go to Publix here? Yeah? Okay. And Ultra was just starting. And we saw a bunch of guys with like neon wigs and sunglasses in Publix. And we were just kind of laughing about it. And I just said, man, this is like, forget people of Walmart, this is like the people of Ultra. And we looked at each other, we're like, we have to see if that domain's available, right? So we set up a Tumblr blog. We set up this great service called ifttt.com. Mm-hmm. This is super awesome, super awesome. I still talk to people from this. And we looked at Instagram, and there was one hashtagged picture on Instagram that said hashtag people of ultra, and it was like some guy that looked really stoned, like it just said I love MDMA on his shirt. And we're like, this is perfect, let's do
that's ultra in one sentence.
Yeah, so we did it. We set up a Tumblr, we set up a method by where if you tagged a picture on Instagram with our tag, it would suck it into ifttt.com, this place I recommend everybody check it out, and then post it in a Tumblr. And it would also save the picture for us, it would tweet it as well. And we created an entire profile in like 3 hours. And so we started telling people that we saw using geolocation in Instagram at the show, hey, then when we saw a picture with faces in it, tag this. And by the way, it went nowhere on Facebook. We have like 100 people on Facebook, but we grew like over 1,000 in a weekend on Instagram because people were like, hey, I want to see this too. There's the engagement. I want to see the other people that are here. I want to see the shots of the people that are at Ultra, not just the performers, because part of going to a show is being in the crowd, not just being on the stage. And I mean, check it out, it's still there, peopleofultra.com.
You guys want to add something?
I think it's a lot harder when you have a brand that people don't care about or something that people don't care about. And so in my personal opinion,
don't
in that situation, you can create an amazing amount of content that has the best visuals and the best creative and the best verbal and all this other stuff, but you're still not getting found. And so in that situation, I feel like no matter what brand, they have to give a little bit of allocated funds to doing promoted stuff. Mm-hmm. Facebook is such a cheap, you can spend $100 a month and get so many impressions. Like I've spent $100 a month for a client and gotten $65,000 people seeing it in 1 month mm-hmm. for $100. So having really strong content is good, but you have to be seen.
Well let me tell you this also. There's a community I started, and if any of you guys want to go join it, it's still new. It's called K9, like the letter K, the letter 9, Watchdogs. And it's just all about instances where police kill personal pets or police dogs are injured in the line of duty. So we started it on a Saturday afternoon with nobody. And I posted this one very evocative photograph of a dog that had been shot in a police incident and survived. And it was a picture of the dog with the dog's story in front of it on her sitting in a field with some stuff in the background. That picture, in a group that had, I want to say at the time, maybe 100 people who liked it, it got over 200,000 impressions in the first week. 200,000 impressions, not paid, not promoted, 200,000 impressions. So even if you have 100 people in your Facebook page, if you post something that's really evocative, that really resonates, it'll go.
To give you some other strategies, I mean, I agree with what you were saying, and also something you said earlier, that your community is out there, you just have to find them. And there are different strategies depending on the network and platform that you're on. Yeah. I definitely agree with throwing money at Facebook, especially when you're in the beginning. You can also do the same thing with Twitter ads. It bumps it up there so people can see. If you have the good content, you can bump it up. With Instagram, the strategy is a little bit different. And if you're a smaller brand, it's going to be harder for you to get any ads. I mean, they're just opening up a little bit now. So
they just made it harder actually last week.
They did?
Yeah, they did.
Okay. Yeah. But what I would do with an organic strategy with Instagram is with Instagram, which especially if you're a highly visual brand, there's a really organic and time consuming, but you can do it. Again, back end research. Mm-hmm. So depending on what the brand is, let's say if it's, I'll go to food because that's what it's like in my head now, I'm hungry. Let's say hashtag foodie, hashtag Miami foodies, hashtag, I would see what hashtags people who love food are using.
Yeah.
I would look for those people and then I would see who they're following. And then I would, I'm giving you like golden strategy right here, copy their followers.
Yeah.
Go back, like their stuff. You know, it's time consuming.
Share their stuff.
Reshare their stuff, give them a little shout out. Again, these are people at the other side. You know, they don't care, like, they want to know that you care about them. You know, so you give a little and you trust me, you can get a lot.
And just think about that, a group of 100 people, no more than the size of this room, could share a post that hundreds of thousands of people will see by the end of this week. it's not about the size, it's about what you're doing with it. And what she said is absolutely right. And yeah. To follow up on that, for Twitter, there's a tool called Tweepi, T-W-E-E-P-I. And what it does is really cool, because it doesn't just tell you who is following somebody that's, say, an influencer in your area, but who is their friend? In other words, who is that person following back? And that's something that's not discussed on Twitter so much, who are Twitter friends, in other words, people that follow each other. But they'll obviously have a lot more affinity in your category than somebody that is simply following the person who that you would like to
be. Yeah, and these two guys do a great job at that. I have, my personal has nothing to do with my brands. In fact, I try absolutely as hard as I can for it to be like, nothing to do with me. But these guys, like, that launches what they do. And Grant is great at that. Like, his personality is so, like, there on Facebook and others. Like, I knew Grant long before I met him in person. And I had been seeing him online.
Very true.
So that helps a lot.
My community, I do definitely have a mixture of online community building and also offline community building. And I actually mix the two a little bit when it comes to my own personal brand. Other tools you can use, by the way, Crowdfire, I like to use. Yeah, Followers Plus for Instagram. I like for Twitter, I love Social Bro. And guys, don't forget about ifttt.com, it will change your life. Okay, that's
it. Well, we're running out of time, guys. Hopefully you had a great experience and got a lot of pros and don'ts and tips to take with you.
Crowdfire and Social Bro.
And thank you.
Thank you guys.
Thank you guys.